guys want some LSD?
Heck yeah, I do! I'm talking limited slip differentials!
When you're turning, your outside wheels gotta go further than your inside wheels. And because each path's a different length, each wheel has to have the ability to rotate at a different speed. And when I say differentials, I'm not talking about how we, as people, are all differential and unique, and that's what makes us beautiful. I'm talking about the little gear train inside what we call a differential. The technology of differentials dates back thousands of years to sometime between 100 BC and 70 BC. And no one knows actually who invented them. So I'm just going to go ahead and take credit. Say that I did.
Yeah, I don't know, just one day it just came to me.
In 1876, James Starley of England invented a chain drive differential for use on bicycles. In 1887, David Shearer used a differential in his Austrian steam car. And in 1932, Porsche used the first limited slip differential. But enough about how all these other folks invented modern differentials. What the heck are they? Turning gets a little tricky if your drive wheels, for this example, your rear wheels, are on only one axle. They can't rotate at different speeds because they're attached. So when you turn, your car explodes. Not really. It's just super inefficient. It's not gonna handle well. It's gonna stutter and skeeter everywhere. Just like my favorite Muppet. So here's an example we can all relate to. You know how we were all in a marching band? Or we've seen marching bands do cool formations at halftime shows? Or we used to bully a band nerd in high school, but then magically switch bodies with them, so we had to learn band culture while they learned being a jock wasn't all it was cracked up to be? Well, all these bandmates are shoulder to shoulder and they're doing a turn. And the band person closest to the axis of the turn is just barely lifting their feet in tiny steps, while the band people on the outside are taking big strides. That's like the wheels on a car. On a sharp turn, the inside wheels need to be able to take baby steps, and the outside wheels need to take big strides so that they can hit that tuba solo. The non-drive wheels don't have a problem with any of this because they don't need to be connected on one axle, and they're just free to move on their own. But the drive wheels need to be connected. Otherwise, your car's one-wheel drive, but the wheels on the axles also have to be allowed to move somewhat independently. Ay, caramba! Relax. That's what the differential's for. You know what else is like a differential? Subscribing to our channel. Do that now. Inside the differential, we've got this pinion gear. Pinion gear is attached to the drive shaft and turns this ring gear. The ring gear causes anyone that watches it to receive a weird phone call and then die 7 days later. This ring gear is connected to a spider gear that rotates with the ring gear, but can also turn on its own axis. This spider gear is meshed with the two side gears, and those two side gears, well, they become the two axles. When the vehicle is going straight, the spider gear and the side gears and axles move as one solid unit. But when the vehicle makes a turn, the spider gear rotates on its axis and the side gears can move at different RPMs. A lot of times, there'll be a second spider gear to handle additional load. And in heavy duty vehicles, you might have four spider gears. Uh-oh, my spider gear is tingling. Oh no, I just had my belt one notch too tight. That's a false spider alarm. Now, while we're looking at the open differential, I want to show you this. That pinion gear is much smaller, and that ring gear is much larger, so they turn at very different speeds. This ratio is called the axle ratio, or sometimes called the final drive ratio. Final drive ratio directly affects your car's acceleration and top speed. A higher final drive ratio, like 4:1, will give good acceleration, but lower top speeds. And a lower final drive ratio, like 3:1, will have a higher top speed, but probably slower acceleration. The gear ratio, just like we discussed in the transmission episode, is the number of teeth on the driven gear divided by the number of teeth on the drive gear. Now, the differential I just described is called an open differential. An open differential is great, because it's inexpensive, it's lightweight, and it requires very little maintenance. Just like me. But unlike me, it's also got a drawback. If you're driving in a situation where one of your rear wheels loses its traction, like if you're on ice, gravel, or a slick patch of baby oil, engine power is always gonna follow the path of least resistance. So if the one drive wheel's traction's different than the other, most of the engine power is going to go to the wheel with the least traction. It slips! And one way to fix this is with a limited slip differential. Limited slip differentials are a great way to limit loss of traction. They're used to limit the amount of independence between the two axles so that the amount of power sent to the wheel with the least traction is limited, and the wheel with the most traction receives continuous power in order to get the vehicle moving. When it comes to a limited slip differential, there's several kinds. There's geared, clutch or plate, and viscous coupling and electronic. And then within those four major methods, there's other layers like wheel speed monitoring or torque vectoring. And for right now, let's just talk on a clutch-based system. Clutch-type LSDs are probably the most popular. In these, the spider gears sit between a pair of pressure rings. These pressure rings are fitted to the outer casing, and the side gears are fitted into the rings. A pair of clutch packs makes up the friction discs, and steel plates are then fitted on both sides of the pressure rings. The clutch packs fit together a lot like sinking rings from our old manual transmission video. The clutch pack should be pressed together at this point, and the frictional force is going to make it move as a solid unit, turning as one axle as the vehicle moves forward. But if one wheel loses traction on a patch of icy baby oil, that engine power going to it will meet with the resistance from the clutch pack as it tries to keep moving as one unit. It's going to divert the energy to the drive wheel for more traction. And that's basically a clutch pack LSD for you. Toyota's got a unique auto LSD system that uses an open differential, but it applies the brakes automatically to the wheel with the least traction, creating resistance to make the wheel with traction the wheel with less resistance. Pretty sneaky, fellas. Another way of solving the problems from open differentials is with a locking differential. And this is particularly useful for off-road vehicles, where you can expect one wheel to lose traction because it's in the air. Locking differentials have a mechanism that will literally lock the axles together when you need it. In this case, both wheels receive equal power so that the wheel with the most traction will always have power. And now, if you really want to go nuts, you can throw on your welding helmet and, well, I mean, that's enough, honestly. If you're wearing a welding helmet and you go anywhere where there's no welding going on, people are going to think you're nuts. But no, put on the welding helmet and weld those spider gears together. Anybody know how we do that? Is anybody? Nobody? What is this, just enough to speed thing? This doesn't work on my show? Well, it's for drifting. A welded diff keeps both of the back wheels spinning at the same speed, and you don't have to buy a new rear axle. Welding the diff minimizes power loss from the drive shaft and makes sure both wheels are always getting power. When you're drifting, the last thing you need is for one tire to be able to follow a different path from the other. You want both of them burning rubber. A welded diff is a backyard fix to make oversteering easier and make it easier to go into a drift. Torque vectoring differentials, which I briefly mentioned when talking about LSDs, groovy man, are the most advanced and complicated. Kind of like me. They use electronic clutches and a separate controller to forcibly slow the wheel on the inside of the turn, sending torque to the outside wheels, powering the vehicle. Now all of this is for a basic rear-wheel drive vehicle, or front wheel, whatever, it's no judgment. But what about four-wheel drive and all-wheel drive? Just so the video is not 28 minutes, basics, full-time four-wheel drive and all-wheel drive vehicles have differentials on the front axle and one on the rear axle. They also have a third differential in the middle of the drivetrain. This allows wheels to move at different speeds and prevents drivetrain binding. All-wheel drive may have an open or limited slip differential in the middle, but the four-wheel drive has a locking differential for when four-wheel drives engage, the center differential locks and all four wheels get sent equal power. But we'll get to that later. Differentials! Thanks for watching this episode of Science Garage, guys. We can't do this without you. Subscribe to Donut, hit this beautiful globe. We've got new shows coming out almost every day of the week. Check out this Up to Speed on Koenigsegg. You know, it'd be cool welding a diff on a cop car. Follow Donut on Twitter and Instagram at Donut Media. Follow me at Bits Bardo. Don't tell my wife she's driving around with a welded diff. She doesn't know.